everyone else, so
that's awesome.
Just a quick intro on the panel. Farin, we've got Serena from the joyful Frugalista. Has a fantastic frugal background and understands a lot about the context of not spending too much or spending in a way that's aligned with your values is a better way to phrase that. Next to Serena, we've got Hayden. Hayden's a student at UC. Oh, still a student, but just been there. Still a student and also working full time. He has a story on his own. It is quite a soft one, looking forward to getting into it. And has just recently started investing this past year.
Yeah, the last 12 months.
Yeah. So for any of those who are younger in the audience, hopefully you're going to get some good insights and context there. And then next to me, we've got Evangeline. Evangeline blogs a little bit on a food blog, right?
Yes, I do have a food blog. It's called Neil Barcode Food, but since having a family, it's just a little bit quiet under at the moment.
Yeah, cool. And has been investing for a long while and has got some really good insights around leaks, ETFs, and hoping to dig in there and get some tangible insights here for anyone who is interested in like what someone interested in the FIRE community. Eventually, has been able to minister some money mustache blog for a long time. Probably might have. Because my story is a co-founder of Pella. I've been investing in ETFs for a long while, but I have a finance background, so the community only, I've been investing in the community's way for a long time. So recently, when I started to try to share with my friends how I invest, that I came across the financial independence community as we were trying to build this investment platform. And that quickly became, all right, we need to make it easy for people to automatically invest in exchange traded funds and mix and do that in a community based way. That's why we're really trying to put the message out about what we do. So, Serena, the second time you've seen the movie, so I won't run to you straight away. Hayden, did you get any insights there and what did you think?
Yeah, absolutely.
Thank you, Kurt. Can you all hear me properly if I'm talking? Yeah, for the first time I've seen that movie, but I've been involved vicariously with FIRE for a little while now, ever since I got started investing, and I wanted to break the chains and blows, so to speak, that I was so held down by a little while ago. But something I got from that was, initially it can be quite difficult, and it can be quite a change, but as long as you stick with the long-term effects and positive makings changing your life, just hugely rich in their abundance. So, for anybody that's looking to make sort of a change or is looking to implement some changes in their life that allow them to seek or obtain financial independence, I think a common theme amongst all of that is definitely just sticking with it. Sticking with it and starting early, I think, was another common theme, is something that I've got on board with. Definitely some of that resonated strongly with me from that moment.
Yeah, cool. And how about yourself?
One thing that really struck me was the payoff as well, the long-term pain and the planning that you need to put into it. But there's always, just to keep in mind, that there is that payoff at the end of it. You're always doing it because of your happiness. And one thing that Taylor really said that resonated was, she's doing all this work, but she's not really seeing the results of it. She could see it on paper, but she wasn't really feeling in her heart. So it sometimes there's a bit of disconnect, and they've gone through the whole process really, really quickly. Not everyone has to jump in that quickly as well. And I think just, again, keep in mind that you have that end goal, and that's what she did, and she's very happy with what she did.
I just, so throwing it back to you, do you feel like you've been on this sacrifice journey so far?
I did this really gradually. So I come from a very spending background and a very unminimalist background, and I was earning good wage, spending it all, not really thinking about it. Then I stumbled upon minimalism. I just had too much stuff, so I came into it through that route. And then some money mustache came around, and then I just realized I didn't really need all these things. These things weren't really making me happy. And there was a bit of pain when I started cycling.
Yep.
Pain.
How far did you cycle?
Well, it's all cycle. I didn't need a gym membership. That's good. And since having kids, we've, you know, calmed down a little bit about it. But all the things that we've set up in the past and all those good habits, it carried through.
Cool.
So we've still got a fairly healthy savings rate.
And how about you, Serena? What do you feel? Do you feel like you've sacrificed a lot on your journey so far?
No, I don't really feel like I've sacrificed a lot. I think in the early days, I felt a little bit resentful. We had homestay students for, I was trying to remember, I think about 6 years. So while my other friends in the office were sort of having TJIF Friday drinks, I was like, I'm going to go home and cook with homestay students. So it was quite a lifestyle change, and like other people would be going overseas and having holidays. It's like, I've just come back from Cuba, I've just come back from the Trans-Siberian. It's like, yeah, we've just paid off the mortgage. But what that, all have been paying down, but what that really enabled us to do was sort of things that you couldn't really sort of see that didn't seem tangible at the time. We bought our first house in 2001 for, just trying to think now, $229,000, I think, 4-bedroom house on the 1,000-meter block, which at the time I was flipping out thinking, like, this is like $250,000. No one around us was really able to afford things like that. But we did that because we had homestay students, and we've always sort of, I guess, done a sort of paid for side hustle or other. So, yeah, at first it sort of felt really hard. I didn't really see the results, but like now I do. Now I certainly do.
Do we have any? Yeah.
Gary and I were just talking to one another, and the fact that it was talking about depriving yourself meant that they were actually doing the wrong things. I mean, they could have just bought a much cheaper house in the area that they were living in. Mm. He could have kept his job. They could have sold the car. Mm-hmm. And she could have gone down to, say, 4 days working a week so she could spend more time with her child. All of her things were about. And they would still have actually got some to where somewhere like where they ended up. They didn't have to go the journey that they went. And I think it's pretty important when you're going on this journey to figure out what is important to you and what you actually want to produce, because whatever any of us reduce, if we're reducing the things that are totally unimportant to us, it's not going to be an issue.
Yeah, I've said it very well, I think. And in fact, there are many different types of fire in a way. You know, there's, and to use the acronyms that are out there, there's Nomad Fire, which is pretty much travel on, and semi-fire where you do some part-time work, and there's a barista fire and a few other ones. I completely agree with your point, is that it's all around values-based living, whether that be values-based spending money, spending time, spending other resources. I think that's why we started there, because for Serena and I reflected on the last one we went to, and it was, the thing that gets us the most is the extremity of work what they did, and the truth is it makes for good film or good video or good cinematography. But is that the only answer? Definitely not. And everyone should find their own kind of authentic path. And there are many. Yes.
The other thing that I would say is that given the enormous number of people on the Mr. Money Mustache forum who are
it also would depend on where people have come from. In their case, they came from like flat zero, not really.
I'm talking about people who
Absolutely, it's all flexible. Depends on the individual savings rates, and the maths is really good. Are there like calculators that people use in the audience to work these things out?
I use Excel as well. I do too.
You can obviously make your own, but if you get a say an Aussie Fiber website, that's what I'm as well. It's ordinary dollar, some couple one, there's a big list that are out there. They're all really useful tools.
There's a few in the Barefoot Investor Facebook groups, there's always different calculators and things in the files. Yeah. So if you get on those groups as well.
So you just go to the shared file section. Just seems like FIRE's a bit more like for one of a better word, extreme version of Barefoot, where it's like a more numbers orientated and investing orientated community. Yeah, it's really cool, like where that's starting to come from. It's almost like a feeder group for the FIRE community in general.
Other questions from the audience?
What do people like want to take away from this? Is it like actionables on where we invest money? Is it spending, savings tips? Is it like what are some insights for after?
We probably have two questions for each of the panel members. One is whether you got a good hack like the burritos that they had in the movie.
A
good way that you've that you found a big saving and something easy that you've been able to implement. Mm-hmm. And the second question is, I guess, how long ago did you start the journey and how far do you think you've got left to go?
Cool. So just to summarise, what's your hack and how far along are you? That's right.
I'll start with burritos.
I'm going to start with burritos. I actually reverse engineered, or at least made up my breakfast burrito recipe, which I wrote a post for Australia's Best Recipe. So you can search under my name online and find it. Because I was really curious, what is this breakfast burrito thing we haven't had in Australia? What is this obsession with breakfast burritos? I had to ask hubby, who's been to San Diego quite a few times with work, and apparently it's a very common California thing. It's a bit like our, bacon and egg roll, but really common, so now people will, have a takeout breakfast burrito, and that's like a really common part of their diet. So I worked out how to make it myself, and you can freeze it, and then in winter we take it, or you can do it in summer too, so it's kind of a nice thing in winter when you're running a bit later in the morning, you can take it to work and you can put it in the toaster, it takes 7 minutes. But in terms of hacks, I have a whole book full of hacks of how to save money. At the moment, the thing I kind of like the most is making my own sourdough bread, which works out about 50 cents versus I think it's $8.50 for Sonoma bread.
$13 even.
$18
actually.
$13 maybe. Yeah, so there's all different ways. Like if you work out, okay, so if you work out that sourdough bread, is important to you, then you can work out how to do that cheaply. If baking isn't your thing, it might be something else. So it's all a matter of what you want to do. And so the second part of that question is, when did you start?
And how long do you think you've got left?
So I guess I started with my ex-husband. We started investing bought our first house in 2001, but really started investing about 2005 in residential property. Then we separated 5 years ago, and I've rebuilt considerably, and I resigned my full-time MPS job just over a month ago. I'm not fully FIRE. I'm still working, but I'm pivoting to do what I love, and I can do that because I'm in a good financial space.
Thank you.
So I'll address the second question in that order, but I'm definitely familiar with my rice cooker. So I started on a Sunday, I cooked rice by the kilo for the entire week. I also play a bit of sport, so my food intake might be a bit more than the average person. Definitely look into the financial incentives of having a Costco membership for sure. Because buying in bulk definitely allows you to save. There wasn't really a particular hack that I applied on the lady. Sure, what was your name? Sorry, up the back here. Yes, it's up. Yes.
Good.
Deborah touched on this. She's some people starting from a negative position as opposed to a zero position. I obviously started this whole journey a little while ago, so I'm very early on. I started from a negative position, a heavily negative one. I made some incredibly reckless decisions at a very low point in my life that I had to try and work my way out of. Some very frugal decisions that I made, cooking lifestyle kilo, applying budgeting techniques, using that spend tracker. I'm not sure about anybody here in the audience, but I got very familiar with pocketbook. Pocketbook helped me, allowed me to track my spending, showed me what my spending was, and showed me a prorated figure on a monthly, quarterly, annually, semi-annually basis. So that really allowed me to compare what I was spending my money on and allow me to actually apply some frugal money saving methods throughout my spending habits effectively. So I don't really have a specific hack, something that hey, this is the thing that's going to save money. Well, I mean, it's just a general mindset that you have to approach your spending habits. Pocketbook might be something for you. Just doing some research into what might help you budget. The second question, I know I went off on a huge tangent there, but the second question was how far down the track, or in that pie chart you saw earlier on, obviously very early on in my journey. We started in the last 12 months, but something that resonates highly with me, which I touched on with Kurt before this, was that I have a huge negative connotation with financial institutions. Something that happened with myself as a 19-year-old, an 18-year-old at the time, making some hugely reckless financial decisions. Now I just shake my head with a prorated annual salary of $18,000, less than $19 an hour. The undergraduate accounting job that I was working at in a different city at the time, Westpac, actually approved me for three platinum MX and MasterCard bonus rewards cards. So I had $60,000 in credit cards with an annual salary of less than $70,000. And I used those to their fullest extent. Facing bankruptcy as a 21-year-old at that time was something I really had to, really, really had to find it myself to work my way out of. I was heavily in the negative position, so I've worked my way to being at the neutral ground, so to speak, being at the zero. It's a funny sort of thing to say that, yes, I'm at zero. I got to zero and last 12 months. It was, I got to zero, and then 12 months ago I sort of thought, well, now I'm at this zero mark, what can I do to try and improve my financial condition? And thankfully I was able to turn a small amount of savings and an even smaller tax return into something respectable. Now that will allow me, there was times in this year, throughout this year, where some of the income streams that I set up for myself were far in excess of the wages I was getting. Please go out there and find my employer and tell them that. There was times throughout the year where the income streams I applied and set out for myself were far in excess of my wages. And that's just as a result of applying this FIRE mindset. There are ways that you can minimize your spending, and there are things that you can cut back on, habits you can get yourself into that will allow you to set yourself up for future for financial independence.
That's a really That's a really compelling story.
Thank you for sharing.
No worries.
That's
really cool. Appreciate it. For the younger ones who are in the audience, like, what's your takeaway?
If you're in a big four institution, then withdraw your savings. Now, just by the nature of particularly now with interest rates being so low. I touched on this with Serena earlier in the week. Right now is a great time if you have any debt to pay it now. It is one thing, something that there was another pie chart that was more on the screen was people who started this journey wish they started earlier. Well, that just couldn't be more true. I mean, the way that debt accrues today and the way compounding interest accrues, one of the other debts as a part of my whole ordeal of making zero was a small $2,000 unsecured loan that I'd gotten through a fifth-tier lender. And that principal amount was $2,000 when it actually ballooned by the usage of compound interest over $5,000. So definitely you should get on this movement and apply these habits as early as possible for anybody who's young, because excuse the pun, it does pay dividends. So starting as early as possible is definitely something I can't recommend highly enough.
Just the original two questions. You remember that?
Well, I'm a bit sorry to disappoint you, but I don't have a food hack, because one of the things they mentioned in the movie, spend lavishly on what you love, and everything else you cut back on. So food is what I love. I spend lavishly on food. Sorry. Probably not well known for, but I like my meat, and I like my dairy. But I know that's what I love. I'm very conscious about what I spend on. So I've made a conscious choice to put my money there. But then I cut back in other areas. Eggs, though, are great. Eat eggs with everything. 5 eggs for breakfast fills you up until well after lunch. So that, maybe that's my tip for you.
Okay. Thank you.
When did I start?
How far along your journey are you?
I probably started when I was about 28, 29, which is about 7 years ago. By my calculations, I've reached independence in 12 and a half years. But then again, you saw how the savings rate went up and down depending on what people did. So I've come out of 2 years of maternity leave. I haven't been working, well, neither my husband or I have been working full time for the last year, well, including me, maybe the last 4 years or so. Our savings rate is still at 45%, but that's a low point for us. I think once we get out of childcare, once the kids start public school, once we're able to go back and work full time, our savings rate will probably climb up to about 75%, again, which is how many years until? Maybe about 7 years. Yeah. So with a bit of paring back, I mean, we'll climb up again, which would put us in about the 10-year mark.
Cool.
At that stage. So some years, yeah, but we both enjoy our jobs. We don't mind. We'll probably work part time, get that balance thing, so that we can still spend time with our kids. But we're still looking forward to that point when we can reach financial independence. Not necessarily quitting our jobs and retiring, because we still like it, but we have the choice now to move to something else if we want to.
Yep. Just treat me on a thought. So, what food? How important was lifestyle inflation for all of you from where you are? Maybe it was pulling back in your case, maybe. But for you too, Benjamin. Said. But how important was that transition, and like for people who either the wages keep rolling through, it's so easy to just keep like, oh, there's more money in the bank, and especially in that like university to first job transition, to spend because it's exciting. How do you like get over the, or even like change that mentality and kind of push against the crowd? Which I guess is the key important question, because as I saw on the screen, that was one of the hardest things. Ellen was playing long game, which I guess is my question after that. Any thoughts on the MS,
right? Did you go to start or off start?
Yeah, you should try and go start. I think I've always one of those parents to people who go first. This is definitely a real issue, especially when you're working in workplaces where there's that kind of pressure to perform and to be seen to be successful. And you know, I mean, I'm not sort of keep up with the Joneses type, but it's sort of like it's just part of your everyday conversation, part of your everyday life. I don't think you realise how sometimes when you're in that, just like how privileged and how lucky we are in Australia. Like when I remember starting a new job and two ladies I was working with comparing where in Italy they bought their shoes from. It's like, oh, mine are from Florence, mine are from Milan. I mean, they were lovely shoes, and they're both very, and we're very well travelled, we both spoke to them in Italian, and it was lovely. But to me, you're sitting there going, oh, well, my shoes were from the op shop. But you know, you sort of subtly suddenly get that message that, you know, being frugal isn't quite right. And suddenly the social things can often revolve around eating out and food. I mean, I'm very blessed to have here a very close and lovely frugal friend. In fact, I have several. I've got one in particular, and I think when you do have those social networks where you are able to socialise with other people who share your values, as you can see with Camp Mustache and others, that certainly makes it easier. But it is really, really hard when you're in that situation. And I know when I was on posting to Taiwan, like everyone knew, I was on posting, you know, as a privileged kind of prestigious kind of role, you know, lived in a nice apartment. So, you know, when it comes to hospitality, you can't just sort of, you know, do something a little bit on the cheap side. There's that expectation that you give nice Christmas presents, or you do nice things, or you entertain in a nice way. There's an awful lot of social pressure to do that. So in a way, it is easy when you start younger, because you know everyone else is sort of in that starting out phase. It gets harder, I think, when you're around you and socialising in different ways. And it can be quite isolating. When everyone else is like, oh, we're just going out to this ball. It's only $150 a ticket, and you're thinking, that's a lot of money. But, you know, to other people, maybe it's nothing. You don't want to, you know, miss out, you don't want to not be part of it. It can get quite difficult.
Yeah, I might be able to add to that. Someone was telling me today, oh, it's only $25 a ticket for this performance, and I mean, I'm sure it's a lovely performance, but for family before, that's $100.
Yeah.
And I was like, what? That's $100! And yeah, and even down to pennies, like taking back your reusable cup, and you save 50 cents, but 50 cents is still 50 cents. One thing that we found really hard to push back on was housing. For the peers that I socialize with and my colleagues, people are easily spending above $1 million in nice areas and having a mortgage that they'll be settled with for life. But very early on, and this is probably one of the biggest factors in us being such a comfortable financial stage now, was we decided, no, we didn't need such a big house, we'll just live in a little apartment. And we lived in a 1.5-bedroom apartment with two kids for a couple of years, and that was fine, it wasn't unbearable. But then we did finally move out of our house last year, but instead of taking the usual sort of house that people move into in the suburbs, we move, another semi-mustache thing, but we move into a town centre, so walking distance from the shops, easy cycling distance to the public school, we could walk to the library, I'm working towards walking to work, just a matter of changing my office. But again, it's still in a nice place, a nice townhouse, but a lot less than what the average Canberra would pay, I think. And just choosing to live in a more modest dwelling has really helped us in our journey.
One thing that sort of resonated with me from both of that is some people don't generally have the ability to cut down on every little thing. Some things are always necessary. So it might be the fact that, you know, you're actually picking every single facet of your life and seeing if you can save 10 cents on buying this milk or doing this thing. It might just be changing your approach to your finances in general, as opposed to categorizing absolutely every little thing and trying to find every single cent you could possibly save. It might just be, you know, initially changing your approach to your financial spending. You know, maybe something as simple as a budget might allow you to compare that to where you were, and maybe it may allow you to identify areas in your finances which you could better change to improve your overall financial position. Hearing a lot of specifics from either side of me, and while it's all very good, and I'm not yet at that stage where I can specifically divide up and categorize and compartmentalize my entire life, it might just be the fact that some people in the audience just need to change their approach or change their mindset with respect to their finances.
How did you make the behavioral change from when you're spending more than you earn to, to saving more?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's definitely naturally, as humans, we're inclined to resist change. I mean, that's just the human condition. As human beings, we want to resist change, and we're comfortable doing what we're doing, and if maybe what we're doing is financially not particularly frugal, or maybe we're more inclined to keep doing that because it's easy. But definitely, it's yeah, absolutely. I think something that was touched on in the film, I'm not sure if her name, the lady who was on Oprah, she, Vicky Roberts, something she said was, it's not necessarily about applying this huge negative connotation and change by a budget. It's sometimes just deciding that something else that's more valuable, maybe it's spending time with your kids, and maybe it's just wanting something else that allows you to make that change, not just, well, now I'm going to draw back on my spending and apply all this negative connotation to my financial condition. Maybe it's just thinking of, well, at the end of all this, I get to spend time with my kids, or I get to do something and to have more time for my life, or travel more, or something like that. Maybe it's the fact that you want that more that allows you to potentially make that change, that first initial step, or make that really difficult financial decision that might put you in a bit of an uncomfortable zone. Maybe it's just having a think about, well, you want this at the end of all of it. Maybe it's worth going through that small period in the scheme of things, small period of adversity, financial adversity, to get this thing at the end of it that you really, really want, which might be traveling or being with your kids more.
Oh, cool. Thanks.
One thing that people can easily do is that as they get more money, not have it visible to them. For instance, having a bank account that you get all of your pay going into, and then you just have a spending account which only gets a certain amount per week. And if you get more money, suddenly start getting more money, you don't notice it because you've still got the same amount going into your spending account. So you're actually looking at your spending account all the time rather than at your total allowance. And that is something that I've seen a lot of people, for a lot of people it means that you don't gradually drift into spending more.
Yeah, cool. That sounds really powerful. I've often heard it phrased the other way, where you have a main one and then you get your direct debit out to your savings account.
Mm-hmm.
But that reversal, it's a really good change of thinking.
Could I add something to
that? Yeah.
I've paid off my mortgage, but when I still had one, my income was sent directly into my mortgage account, and then when I wanted to pay something like my credit card bill off, I'd have to take it out of my mortgage account. And seeing my mortgage balance go up was a real disincentive to spending that money.
That's a great behavioral trigger there.
especially when you get
down to the end, when you're almost about to pay off the mortgage, and you go from zero to up, and you're just like, I just want to have it paid off. I want it to stay at zero.
Yep.
It's just the last little bit.
I do want to make a point though that I don't think anyone on this stage is perfect in how they save money. And coming back to the tip and the hacks, mine is I pretty much eat cans of tuna, avocado, and a loaf of whole milk bread for most of my lunches in the work week. But I will go through periods where I'll do that for 2 months and then I won't eat tuna and avocado for 2 weeks. Also I do a bubble tea. It's kind of like efficiency, and that's kind of, anyway, the point is, splurging happens, and it's just getting back, as we need a good habit, just to come back to it and keep driving through, and we're going to be consistent with whatever the goal is, right? And that kind of brings it back to, yeah, sure, you're shooting to a big goal, but also the spending that you make, just keeping in the mind of a framework. All right, how many hours of my life is this? It's a pretty compelling framework. Let's go down to actual investing. How do you make the call about what you have invested in, and what are you invested in, like, totally, but in the last 12 months, in terms of both
property and shares and any other assets that create passive income, what have you invested in?
I actually haven't invested in anything because I've been fully occupied with paying off my mortgage.
Okay.
But in general, and I still have my share portfolio from before I had that mortgage, I like going for LEITs and ETFs, very passive investments, set and forget, and don't even think about it. Maybe
who knows what LEITs and ETFs are? Just, yeah, okay, cool.
Usual suspects, VAS, BTS, VU, get something with low fees and LICs, AFI, Milton.
Why did you choose to go some LICs, some ETFs?
Just for a bit of balance and the different options they offer. For LICs, I like the dividend reinvestment schemes that they've done with.
Can you speak a bit more about that?
I think,
not what they're called, but why you'd go for a LIC rather than an ETF reinvestment scheme.
Sure. One of the LICs that I'm with, they have a particular scheme where it's pretty much like dividend reinvestment, but they've structured it so that you don't pay the tax until when you start drawing on the funds. So you put off the tax event until later on, when presumably your taxable income is less when you're in retirement. So that's a nice one for us. Definitely an incentive to investigate in that particular one.
What's dividend reinvestment plans generally? How important are they?
They're great because we don't need the income now. We're still in our earning stage. The dividends, they're just like savings. They just get rolled over, your investment gets bigger, and your money works harder for you. If you get the dividends, then you know it's cash. You might be tempted to spend it.
I just had a bit.
Yeah.
So like in Australia, the structure of our market is that we have this thing called franking credits, which I'm sure a fair proportion of the audience knows about. Franking credits mean that in Australia, there's a higher incentive for companies to pay dividends than in other markets because we don't get double tax. That's what the franking credits do. And because of that, we get these higher dividends, typically around 3 to 4% per annum companies will pay out if they're a mature company on the ASX, which is great because we get a steady kind of passive income stream when we're towards the end. We're wanting to actually use this passive income because it means that dividend payments are a lot more steady than what market capitalization is. So if you're looking at a lot of the US content that comes out, they talk about a 4% rule, which is like a sell down 4% over time of whatever the asset's net worth is something that you should be able to rely on to steadily draw down without your overall portfolio value deteriorating in real terms. Did I keep most people there? Okay, cool. Whereas in Australia, the context is that we have like a good portion of the return comes in dividends. And so to continue to snowball, you need to make sure that your reinvestment, whether they're like reinvestment plans or whether they be up through other means, like just continuing to put your money back into the same like target portfolio. But in Australia also, we have the additional benefit if you're in the ASX of being able to get that steadier income stream when you do hit your FIRE goal, which is pretty cool. And there's a big debate in the community about like how heavily weighted should you be in Australia versus the US versus the rest of the world. A very common approach is a third Australia, a third US, third rest of the world, commonly executed by A200, Beta Shares, VEU, Vanguard's All World excluding US, and VTS, Vanguard's Total US. That's probably the most common approach. Second one would be 50% Australian, 50% rest of the world through the VGS, Vanguard, All World ETF. I just wanted to get actual tangibles so we had somewhere to start. Hayden, what are you invested in?
Obviously less exciting sort of stuff, but I mean I started appealing mainly on appealing it to the youth and those people who are very, very, very early on in their journey, but you know obviously market. Helped largely by ComSec, computer availability. But I mean, we live in an information age. ASX is really easy to take advantage of. I wouldn't recommend it if you're looking for something consistent and passive. When I first started, I mean, chucking five and six grand into zip pay. I was telling my partner at the time, hey, this is all good, I've made $800 today, and one thing, and then the next day, oh my god, I've lost $2,000. And she's thinking, well, what the heck is actually going on? What are you doing? I started off with a sort of an approach to short-term value investing. I had a list of stocks that I thought, look, these over the next 12 to 18 months are going to go up. And they did, which was fantastic. I got some terrible financial advice from a close family friend to buy this new thing called Bitcoin. that did not go well. So I bought a Bitcoin, and now they're worth a lot less than what I bought it. So I really wouldn't recommend going too far into cryptocurrency. I touched on really some of the income streams that I had have become higher than my wage as well. I highly recommend people looking into your decision as to whether or not you act on this advice, quote unquote advice, looking into fixed income solutions, something that might provide you with something steady and passive. I'm not too inclined this early on in my career to go towards bonds. I think that market is completely saturated and they don't provide a particularly adequate return, particularly to those early on in their career. Maybe large amounts in the back end of your journey might be attractive, maybe, but that's a decision for you. Obviously, there's earning a passive income for rental property. Well, obviously, early on in my career, it's not something I can easily obtain, nor can many people early on in their career particularly easily obtain. A lot of people trying to negatively gear their properties earlier in their careers by borrowing and then getting a family or a friend member or somebody in there just for some rents that they can completely negatively gear their rent for. It just doesn't work like that. I mean, you can definitely try that, but it's not a particularly attractive investment for somebody who's looking to value invest early on in their career. But for me personally, I was hugely attracted to the growth rates that were offered by the stock market and by fixed income solutions. It's now only been since my involvement in the FIRE movement that I've started looking into ETFs and things of that nature. But again, very early on in my career, not a whole lot of money to play with. I think there's more valuable alternatives for me this early on for people of my age bracket and for people early on in their journey to try and put their money towards, really. But definitely something to look into later on in your journey, but I don't think earlier on it's particularly attractive for me personally, at least anyway. Yeah, sorry.
ETFs have been proven to be a much better solution than any individual shares.
That's fantastic, but for somebody who's as young as me with not a lot of money, what's the point of chucking $5,000 into an ETF?
But an ETF,
absolutely.
ETFs are a far better thing to do, even for people starting out in their career. And those people in that film putting their money, their first bit of savings, into an ETF. And that's what John Collins was saying that they should do. And really, John's right.
Okay, that's completely respect that. Again, might be a subjective topic, but for my circumstances personally, if I had chucked my money into ETF, I'd still be paying off those Westpac credit cards.
Absolutely.
So I think it wasn't debated that you needed to pay off the debt.
Absolutely.
But like, and so just for everyone, if people do have debts, like, you know, it's always the smartest thing to pay off an unsecured loan or anything that pretty much isn't tied to an asset before you start investing. It's like without a doubt, because you've got like a 0% volatility loan, you are going to be paying off 21% on that credit card until you ever pay, or until 12% on that unsecured personal loan until you get paid. So like, it's a no-brainer. But the question then becomes, okay, where do you invest? And I started investing in 15, and I started trying to pick stocks. I tried to pick stocks for 5 years, and then I compared my returns at the end of those 5 years. I spent, I would say, a couple hundred hours like actually doing those investments. And I did my analysis, and I was one of the lucky ones. And I got flat with the market after 200 hours or more of work. But I think I encourage anyone to start investing, no matter how they do it. And honestly, there's people who are good at stock picking, and they do manage to continually outperform in a small market space and small cap space. And it does appeal to young guys in particular, but also young guys often get burnt doing. Like I was on the path to probably do it. You might be able to outperform me, don't you? And just like that process is, anyway, it's something to, I want to encourage it, and I think in general it's good if we do, because it means people are starting to put their money in their investments in a way that like, helps them achieve their goals long term. Like, it's a different thing. But moving on from,
I want to talk about investing. So I sold my index funds. I sold them earlier this year. And then they got like, oh, you should do that and buy. You should have index funds. You should have ETFs. And I sold them. And I did that because I really wanted to take advantage of the record low interest rates, and I wanted to pay off the mortgage. And also to, you know, Poppy and I had a discussion about what our goals were for the year, financial goals. He's a much more conservative investor than I am. And, you know, we really just wanted to pay off the mortgage. In fact, he said, because I knew I wanted to quit my job at some point, he said I couldn't do it until I paid off the mortgage. Well, we haven't quite, but we've got close enough that he's happy to do that. And I guess I just wanted to point out too that, you know, what's happening in your relationship and what stage you're at, you know, often does determine what your risk profile is. But there's different things happening at different times. You know, as a mother of young children, you know, a big priority for me is providing safe housing. It's where I am in my life right now, which may be different to how safe is. You know, so there's different stages, and that does influence what your risk profile is for investing, and that's totally valid. But for me, I just see these record low interest rates as just a phenomenal opportunity for paying down debt. So either small mortgage now, like where we live, and I've also got another 4 investment properties to my hubby and to myself. So that just made sense to me to focus on that. Beyond that, we also do have some shares. Hubby also got very spooked. Sounds a little bit like having my lead have a discussion about to talk to our other halves about investments. But we started in January last year, and the market was kind of okay, and it wasn't okay. It's never been rebounded. But I keep pointing out that the dividends and the dividend reinvestments are actually not too bad. So if you sold it, you couldn't get the same return from the bank. So it's not fantastic. But, you know, it isn't worth us realising the losses at this stage if we're keeping it. But then at Christmas time, I sort of said to him, well, you know that one where we did buy up here? Well, it's like really down here now, so I think we should buy lots. And he's like, oh, no, I think so. And one of those has now come up 22%. So, you know, timing the market is really important, but it's also having the stomach for it. You know, it's all fine to talk about the maths and the numbers, but the psychology of the investing is so important. And no way was Hubby going to buy more shares after they'd already fallen at that point.
That's a really good point. I just want to add something, but then come back to you. So, like, 10-year horizon is what we're talking about, at least in this context. 10-year horizon is like what we're talking about. And I mentioned all equity portfolios before, and that was probably irresponsible. For a lot of people, especially if you're just starting out, it's good to have a mixed asset class. And that the reason being that, you know, if you say have some bonds or some gold in ETFs in your portfolio, they will give you
your portfolio support in negative times, and that will help you navigate those periods. And the context around like how difficult has it been for like you mentally is something that's like worth discussing, because you need to actually have a long talking about this with a few other FI bloggers. It's like, okay, I know that if I've got a really long time horizon, then more equities portfolio is like what I want, but also I know that it's going to be very stressful when the markets turn south, particularly the dollar cost average. What are some support structures I can put in place so that I can stay the course? And that was something Dale Collins mentioned in this film. And I think it's just something that but it was pointed out that there's a lot of like younger bloggers in the space who probably haven't experienced any significant financial crash. Like if you look at Strongman Australia, Firebug, all started investing post GFC, right? Whereas if you go to say an FI Explorer page or a Hi-Fi page, they're a lot wiser heads. They're typically at that 40, 50 year old mark, and they have invested through the GFC, and it's stark the difference that they actually all hold gold. They both hold gold, whereas both the young guys don't. They both hold some sort of like other like asset class diversification, whereas both the young guys don't. You didn't hold that. So who knows whether like is it just brashness or is it a difference? And it's something to be aware of, at least as you're reading through and getting resources. How do you manage your like mindset when we're going through?
The blink is gone. We're still in our earning stage. We've still got many years more of income and potential. So it actually doesn't worry us very much at all. The money's parked there, and we keep adding to it when we can. And then it just stays parked away until we need it when we're retired.
So you just shut up.
Yeah. If it's there, it stays there. We don't touch it.
We do
regularly look over what we have, holdings, you know, balancing it out. We use an analysis of, so what else do we get that's to diversify the portfolio. We have sold our managed funds as well.
Okay.
But they weren't doing very well. The managed funds and the service fees were really high. They came well recommended from a family member.
Family members.
But we also thought that we would get a better return from paying off a mortgage.
Yeah.
So we, but they were the worst performing parts of our portfolio. So we still held the ETS in the weeks.
Yeah. How about yourself when you've suffered like volatility here?
Yeah. I mean, earlier on in the year, I had a huge holding. In fact, we currently experience a sort of a mini afterpay crash. The number was down 20% last month. It's down 25%, and then up a little bit. And again, my partner's still looking at me, going, "Well, one day you're saying you've lost this many thousands of dollars, and the next day you're saying you've made it back, and the next day we've lost it again. I can't give up." it's something, particularly from a news standpoint, it's something that's starting to become very acutely aware of, is that we're unsure if there is turmoil in the future, particularly in the economy, is that there's so much going on in the media about how, well, you know, the heralds are singing on rooftops, there's going to be no collapse, but then the RBA is coming out and saying, well, you're actually fine. There's so much going on, particularly for somebody who is at the point where I would like to start looking to create a passive income and purchase of a real property asset. That is something where I probably was at maybe a few months ago, but I really haven't made that decision purely because of this uncertainty. As somebody who is pretty informed with financial markets and the interact with the Australian economy, I'm particularly uncertain about what the future lies, but regardless of all of that, I'm still looking and still actively pursuing value-based investments, particularly particularly at the moment in the stock market, though, it's something I would like to get out of because I don't know if my relationship can sustain any more share market volatility. So I am very, very, very aware of risk profiles of some of the holdings, some of the investments that I'm even trying to mitigate some of that risk and hedge some of that risk as much as possible. And for the foreseeable future, I'm going to be working towards, or trying to work towards, turning that into passive investments as opposed to volatile stock market based investments, where over the short term, get some value out of where I want the stock market, but for the long term, I'm really looking to get out of that investment that's so influenced and exposed to volatility in market.
Does it feel like a part-time job at the moment?
Oh yeah, absolutely. I mean, it's almost like with the availability of CommSec and CS markets and plus 500. I mean, it's almost like I'm working two full-time jobs because while I'm working away at work, I've got my phone out. All these apps, and I'm constantly Googling and finding myself. I'm doing this on this screen, or I'm quickly, doing CIC on my right screen. I'm doing something over here, or I'll quickly bring up BTC markets to see how much more money I've lost. I'm constantly, something I'm not particularly happy with is that I put money on this pedestal. Admittedly, I put money on this pedestal, and I wouldn't say I'm borderline obsessed with it, but I'm always 24/7. Aware of it and checking up on it and seeing what it's doing, and I'm constantly worried about it, which is something that I feel like the FIRE movement is trying to stray away from. It's funny to admit it, you're trying to break the chains associated with being so financially chained down effectively. And I can say with somebody early on in the process, I'm really, really chained down. However, I can see there is light at the end of the tunnel.
That's awesome.
There is light there.
Something to that.
Absolutely.
I'm very surprised you have that attitude to your share market portfolio, because for me it's honestly set and forget.
Yeah.
Put it in there. I haven't looked at the figures and the returns that I got until only a few days ago when I knew I was going to come on this panel. It's set and forget. I know the money's working for me in the background. Every quarter I get a nice little dividend notice coming in and I go, interesting. File it away. But I also do have a rental property that I felt like I spent a lot more time worrying over than my shares, because the shares, they're liquid and they're in such smaller amounts that it doesn't matter as much as this large sum of capital that you have parked in this house with tenants that you don't know what they're doing to your house. My husband used to drive past the house all the time, have to look at the lights on. Are they on the balcony? That just felt like a lot more stress involved there, which is why we sold it, than just having it sitting away in the market. But again, it might come to your personal preferences in investments and just more of that.
I was in your shoes 6 years ago. That's exactly how I felt. It was like I was working and stock market was my job, but it wasn't paying me enough, but it's just to buy it, and so there has to be a better way than I'm at this week. And we'll see how it goes. Serena, I really also, we did focus a lot on from investments so far that we're in the share market.
Yeah.
Just really correctly, was brought up property, decent passive income stream, and if you use it well, you've got an innovative way to draw your passive income stream.
Yeah, so apologies, my feet are both a bit tired, I think, so they're holding up really well, so I just want to acknowledge how well they're doing, and
similar to how I react when I get tired.
That's how the paper says. So as I do Airbnb from one of my investment properties, and I also do it from home from time to time, and it is a lot of work, to be honest. It's not a simple, everything is rosy and everything's fabulous. It is a lot of work, and sometimes it can be trying. In fact, I had the first ever time this week where I didn't ask someone to leave, but I just pointed out that they really probably shouldn't be in share accommodation that particular week, and they chose to leave, and it was a bit nasty for a while, but it's calmed down now, but certainly the returns from that have been good. For the rental property, it is at least doubled what we had previously coming in. bummed about that because I prefer faster, but that's okay. They're their guest earners, I think, 4 or 5 times. And I really like people, and I really like guests. I'm really passionate about welcoming people to Canberra and introducing people to Canberra and their experience. And I've met some amazing people, including this couple, and I was talking to them, because their daughter was at ANU, and they're from the same suburb I grew up in Melbourne. Anyway, it turned out this is his second marriage. His daughter from his first marriage, she used to be my primary school good friend for about 3 years in primary school in Melbourne, and we did the interview to later. So, you know, I think it's not just an income stream, it also fits with my values about community and about connecting with people in a meaningful way. That's what doesn't always work. But even then, there's kind of a happy ending from that. And before we did do an event there for about 6 years, we had homestay students at home. So, once again, you know, providing more than accommodation, you know, introducing people to Australian culture and to life in Canberra.
Is there any questions or even comments about like side income streams and increasing passive income in other individuals? Yeah.
I had a question. It was more around financial investing and financial advice. Do you seek paid financial advice, or do you sort of go on your own path and make your own decisions from, based on your own research? Just want to get the sort of feel of where financial advice comes in.
Again, I think my answer is going to vary pretty heavily from those other side of me. The answer to that is no for myself. Particularly in an age where there is such an abundance of information. I think some people getting started or starting their journey might really benefit from going and seeking that advice and getting some sort of direction. But for me personally, particularly, with so much information at our fingertips, I couldn't justify paying for it. But again, that might be hugely, again, it's very subjective in my mind. People on the side of me might have a different opinion from myself. I didn't think maybe later on, when there's more at stake, I can benefit off of somebody's public liability insurance. I couldn't justify it. So.
Yep. Yeah, that's a really interesting question. I do have a financial plan I work with, but I work with professionally. From time to time, I will ask his advice, and he'll give me really honest advice, and he's given me some really good strategic advice about superannuation in particular. And that's kind of that, because he approached me to write certain things for him. He's someone that I find who's very ethical. However, would I be paying for his full fee service? It would be very expensive, to be honest. And in the past, some of my interactions with financial planners haven't been that fantastic. Like in the peak of the stock market boom before the GFC, for instance, about a year before the GFC, we met with a financial planner who advised us to heavily leverage our home property to take out a lot of equity and to put it all in the stock cheap. I know you're looking and going, what? So having a margined, highly leveraged stock market. So you can imagine the stock market would have crashed and, you know, caught a margin call on that and you could have lost the house. And I was just staring at her going, are you for real? And she's like, oh, you know, the returns are so good and blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, why on earth would I take money out of my mortgage to invest in that way at a time when the market's running hot? And also my Nana, when she was going into a retirement village, she sought the advice of a financial planner who advised her to put into a super, super, super safe real estate investment trust so she could still draw a pension. And that was promptly frozen about a year or two later when the GFC hit and she's never seen any of that money again. I think one of the problems is with the financial planning model is because it's often tied to commissions or it's tied to very expensive fees, is if you are not really getting unbiased advice when you see them. And even, you know, for the good ones, they feel very constrained too, because there are so much legislation in place to protect people. They can't actually really tell you really honest things sometimes. I know that sounds obvious, but they are actually really constrained in what they can tell you as a client because of the model. I actually want to get into wealth coaching, and when I say that, it's not saying to people, you should buy this share, or you should buy this product, or you should buy this insurance. But I'm really interested in this nexus, the psychological aspect of, you know, I think most people know they probably should, and I don't use the word should lightly, but, you know, should or could have a budget, or that they're spending too much, or that they know they could be putting more into super, but they're not actually doing that. And I'm really interested in that behavioural aspect of what is it about our lives that we're not doing that. And I guess I'm more interested in being a sounding board and a listening board to try and encourage people to identify what they really want to do with their money, rather than necessarily having a technical plan and telling people what they should do.
Sorry, I just want to add as well. Whilst I didn't pay for any financial advice, I actively sought as much advice as possible from every person I possibly could. So whilst I didn't pay for it, I was actively seeking advice from people who I felt were informed and had experience.
Similar to you, I think, Aidan, I haven't paid for my actual advice, but I do. I have researched heavily. Money Massage, Mr. Money Massage Australian forums, the various Aussie financial blogs like Firebug and all that. And I've settled, since then I've like settled on my investment strategy, and I'm pretty happy with just sticking to that. So it's just a very simple strategy, but something that seems to work for most people. Am I maximizing my income earning potential from that? Maybe not, but with the amount of time and effort I spend on it, I'm pretty happy with what I get.
It's a really great balance. I think just reflecting on this, so I haven't spent any money on a financial planner or any financial professionals, but my parents have. And I'm just reflecting on that a bit more, and I think it's the right play in both cases. And the reason is because when you're younger, your situation tends to be quite simple and quite easy to just figure out by like talking and leveraging free information that's out there, but as you age, your financial situation becomes more complex and does become more tailored to you as an individual. And I'm just thinking about we're talking about superannuation. My parents are transitioning from the super stage to the pension stage with their SMSF, and there's a lot of intricacy around that. And it's like going through that, like, there's no way we get the right result if it was just us like going at it ourselves.
Did you have an extra question?
Just a comment. I think it's really interesting, like the varied approaches people have towards investing. And the takeaway for me is that, regardless of whether you decide to invest in shares or property or ETFs, LLCs or direct investing, I think the takeaway for me is that, you need to be clear on why you're investing in something and why you've chosen to invest in a certain product. And also, how's that going to get you to where your goal is? So I think that's for me like the key takeaway of that. And also, I also like to follow Warren Buffett's advice. It's only invest in things that you understand. How's this going to make me money? How's this going to help?
Yeah. Yeah, the same. If I plan to own it for 10 years, I plan to own it for 1 year. Listening again, it seems like also what's it to you in terms of like your stress? Is it going to be a part-time job? Is it truly passive income? Or how passive can this income stream be? Is an important part of like the factor. Now I'm just answering your questions.
How do you get into ETFs? What's the easiest way? Or how can you find information how you can get into it?
Yeah, for sure. Easiest way. You have a major bank account, probably, like a Combank, Westpac, that, ANZ. They all have their own platforms that you can invest in directly into ETFs. And they're not the cheapest, but they're the easiest. And they're not exorbitantly expensive, and like you can transfer very easily. Like you can transfer it to a Pearl very easily, and you can just run everything across. Yeah, I did assume you're talking about outside of super. Outside, okay. And so you can just open your bank. We'll have a brokering platform.
I'm with a different bank, like Defence Bank, sort of.
Right. In that case, open a self-wealth account. Self-wealth is what it's called. They have a $9.50 brokerage. It's the cheapest in the market at the moment. We are coming in the market as of next year, and we'll match that price. It's a trading interface, so it is short-term focused, which is our big gripe, and it's our differentiator. is that we're trying to help self-directed investors investing for 10 years rather than investing for one, which is what most of these other interfaces do.
Mm-hmm.
So just make sure when you get on the platform, you don't get overwhelmed with all the data and all the things that they try to make you look at every day, because you will need to make an active effort to like go, okay, this is not, it's not a part-time job. But that aside, get on, open up a self-log account, it costs you $9.50 every time you buy a VAS or a VGS or whatever it is you want to buy. And to actually look at other people's portfolios after we get outside of tonight, and I can send this through if you want. Like, we have a link to an FI resources page, and it has like a lot of the top FI bloggers in Australia, just in one page, as well as a bunch of the communities, like the online communities that you can look at. Is that something that is of value?
Sure.
Okay. Cool. And so you can look at how they invest, and you can just look at the actual tickers and even what their portfolios are worth. All of this information is free, which is the brilliance of the community.
I just wanted to say, it's just exactly the same as investing in shares. It's exactly the same as buying a share, a normal share on the ASX. You can also get the tickers on the Apple stocks, if you have an Apple phone or Yahoo stocks. So it's very accessible. It's just as easy as, it's not any more complex. It's
I wanted to leverage of your knowledge. What's the easiest way to do it? I mean, there's so much information out there, and you can spend heaps of time just trying to figure out things, and I just don't want to spend that much time.
Oh, key thing is just getting onto a platform with the cheapest fees,
which is
self-wealth.
I know of people who, on the information side of things, who like having as much information as possible, and like having all the analytics. All of the overwhelming things, and I'm aware of them using CIC and plus 500. So I know you said you did one of the overwhelming stuff, so if anyone out there is interested, there are those two providers that are aware of that service.
I use Bell Direct, I'm happy with it, but it is more expensive than Self-Op.
Yeah, you were going to take a poll of people in the FIRE community, majority are split with either CompSec because they can't be bothered to switch to self-wealth because self-wealth is the cheapest and CompSec's the biggest. And then you have a sprinkling of people outside of that in like Bell Direct and CMC, which are like a bit between those two at different stages. Is that fair to say?
Mm. And it depends on how many times you intend to buy as well. If you don't buy a lot in a year, then it doesn't matter as much how much the leverage fees are.
Yeah, which is why I suggested starting with a big bank, because it's really easy to open if you've never opened a share investing account before. If you don't have a big bank, then you've got to go through the problems anyway. And so, yeah, typically if it's Vanguard, then it's going to be pretty good. That's a good way to get started. Everyone who is online investing in this one Vanguard ETF.
There's also the Vanguard managed funds option.
Yeah.
They haven't actually, this is a really good point.
Yeah.
This is a really good point. Yeah, do you want to talk to them?
Do you know what the brand's called?
Yeah, it's the balanced portfolio.
Yeah.
So VDHG is the ticker. And they have what they call is, instead of having to piece them all together, they will do one for you. So it'll be, it's like, I don't know the exact percentage.
Seven ETFs.
Seven.
Yeah. Thanks. So it's got BAS, which is the Australian market, then the whole world, which is about 20%, the small market.
Cool.
There's fixed income, which is bonds.
Yeah.
Fixed income component, which is 10%.
Yep.
I think I said small markets, and I can't remember the other. But yeah, it's seven auto balances.
And
does you have over 100,000, you can go direct to their wholesale fund.
Cool.
Which is about 0.29% MER.
Mm.
How do you get
them? Actually, a lot of people, I'm not going to stay sure, have got into the wholesale thing.
Mm.
So just they advertise, their advertised rate is $500,000 from the US. You can call directly and get 100,000, and I think there's cases where people will get less. The benefit of that is the MER, so the fee you pay is far less. If you buy the ETF directly, it's 27 MER,
And so just to make clear for people in the audience, the benefits of doing like an index fund as opposed to an ETF is that you can incrementally invest in it over time and not have to deal with the broker fee. Mm-hmm. And so there's this trade-off between the broking fee and the ETF fee, which is like you get a higher ETF fee usually, except unless you get to the wholesale fund level on the index side. And then on the ETF side, you've got to deal with the broking fee, or you've got a lower fund fee. That's fair to say, right?
Yeah. And you can set up, like you said, there's no brokerage and it's just be paid in. So you can set up an automatic be paid from your bank account once a month, which is a sort of set and forget style of investing.
Yeah. It's quite massive. Yeah. So it's the way you can automate it at the moment. Although we're going to change that next year with
Yeah, surely better if you have small amounts of money that you just want to drip feed in. But I think once you get over $5,000 in the lot, then it's better to go to a brokerage.
Typically, yeah, unless you can get to the 100K mark. Cool. Other questions? Okay, thanks. We're feeling pretty good. Last one, well, thanks everyone for coming out and having a chat. Cheers.